I'm here to talk about raising clownfish. We started about 4 years ago with saddleback clams. I just fell in love with these guys. And when I really got them because of an anemone, carpet anemone. So I have to get these clownfish. Then I started watching them doing this. And it's like, oh my God, I have to learn how to raise these babies. So I did a lot of research, talked with a lot of groups, read Joyce Wilkerson's book, that's probably the best foundation that got us started, and then trial and error. You know, when you first do it, you're going to make mistakes. No matter how much you plan, you're going to make mistakes. But we've been pretty successful for about 4 years now. As a matter of fact, this pair that you're watching right now, we collected 3 weeks ago. We have about 3 weeks old. We have about 100 babies that are have gone through metamorphosis now. Anybody here raising clownfish? Are you raising them?
I just started reading this last
week. Oh, you did? What's your name? Oh, yes, yes, yes. Hi, it's good to meet you. Yeah. And did you start with the eggs yet?
I've lost layers. They've hatched 5 times. I try to collect them. I'm unsuccessful during my reset. So every time they hatch, I'm not either sleeping or the baby's hatching. They eat them off.
Yeah.
I take their pie, put them down, so they become natural time child.
That's great. That's great. I think this might help because I'm gonna focus on a few things, but basically keeping them alive. So hopefully we can help you with this. Sorry. Most of this presentation is gonna focus on you already have your mate of hair, you already have your spawning environment. But if you haven't, here's just a few tips that can help your clownfish mate. No stress. You can't have any stress in that tank. And that means good tank parameters, friendly tank mates. I can't stress that enough. We have a few, you'll be seeing this too, I think. We have a few plate pack mates who just love to mess with long spawning. But other than that, it's a great environment. Safe shelter. I think the best is with an anemone. But a lot of us aren't so fortunate. Our clowns have lines of their own. So they like to have either a coral or some rock that they can hide in. Make sure you have safe shelter for them. Good nutrition, can't stress that enough. You see your fish laying these eggs. Don't collect on the first or second batch. I always say wait for the fifth or sixth batch. But then you're going to know. It's going to develop a routine. Once you see that routine, beef up on their nutrition. Feed them twice a day instead of once a day. Feed them really nutritional foods. Like I love the 5-star from Mary. Rod's food is good too, but nutrition is really important so that you have healthy eggs. And then consistency. Don't go changing your aquascape because they're not going to spawn for you. Don't be adding new fish in there. If you're dedicated to this, keep your tank environment consistent. A few little tips here. I know people get all excited. I want to buy a native pair that's already with the anemone. It's so much more fun when you get the clownfish that you want. Get them young. And I almost guarantee you, within a year, they're going to be a mated pair. If you have this environment going, you're going to have a mated pair. And it's fun to watch that transformation as well. Also, a tile or flat rock. A lot of times we have sand substrate in our tanks. Chris and I have a bare bottom, so that makes it easy for ours. And if they're hosting with coral, a lot of times they will lay the eggs on the base of that coral. They're not going to stick. So if you can get them started and trained on a little piece of flat piece of live rock or tile where their nesting area is, they will start using that tile, and that's going to be healthier for the eggs as well. wait until batch number 5 or 6. Each batch gets bigger and the eggs get healthier. And it also, it helps with you so that you know it's going to be day 8 every time, or it's going to be day 9. Joyce Wilkerson's book, I say read it once or twice at least. It's a great foundation. We use most of her guidelines and we've adapted accordingly. Everybody's going to be different, but it's a great foundation. And I have to mention our foreign breeds. We have an extensive aquaculture and breeding forum, and a lot of people are breeding clownfish, Picasso clownfish, cardinal fish. We're all learning from each other, so that's a great resource for helping you raise your family. Because there are so many steps involved, the two that are the most important is planning for it and then keeping those fish alive. So that's what I'm going to focus on today. All right, 7 keys. I think everyone's heard of the 5 keys, but I like to follow the 7 keys, and that's proper prior planning prevents piss poor performance. And I'm glad we don't have any young guys in this time. I can't stress enough the planning, and that's why I include the prior in there. But also, with this planning, if you follow those steps and you have everything in order, it's going to make life so much easier for you. The planning process starts with the research. And everybody, can you guys hear me back there too? Is my voice loud enough? Yeah? Okay. Research, 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 read, ask questions, go on the forums, plan before you start this process. Food is huge. The first source of food for these babies is live rodents. We tried substituting, it doesn't work. You might have a few that make it through, you're lucky if you do. Live rotifers is your first food chain, and you have to plan for that. A tank. I keep that separate from the equipment, because I think it's really important to have a dedicated tank. I'll explain a little bit more about the baby tank with the next slide. Equipment, you just need a little bit of equipment. We'll go over that as well. Time and passion. If you're in this to just make money, I don't know how successful you're going to be. We're all hobbyists here. If you really want to devote some time and dedication to it, you're going to be a success with these babies. I don't know how good these slides are because we have this bright, bright light. So I'm going to try my best to talk it to you. Food is something you have to plan for, as I mentioned. Because it's so important, I have a separate slide just on rotifers. But I need to mention it again. If you don't succeed with your rotifers, you won't succeed with your babies. Dedicated tank. This is really dark, but we take a 10-gallon tank, we paint the two sides and the back of it black. I don't like dealing with the plastic trash bags. The trash bags do make the tank inside hotter, so it's really hard to judge the temperature of your babies. Go ahead and dedicate that tank, paint it. Paint the bottom white. It's going to make it a lot easier for you to clean the tank, to see what's dead, what's not. Start with 3 gallons from the parent tank the night of hatching. It's so important that the parent tank mirrors your baby tank for the first 3 days. If you don't have that going for you, you're going to lose a lot of your babies within the first 24 hours. Also with the tank, we start with phytoplankton for our rotifers. We pour enough density for the rotifers, which I'm going to get into again, and phytoplankton so that it's a co-culturing. We're going to have the larva in the baby tank along with the rotifers and the phytoplankton. That keeps it a healthy, nutritional environment for the babies the first 3 days. And then we have equipment over here. You just have a few basic things you need to get. A lot of this can be purchased at your local hardware store. So you have an overhead light. You have an aquadose because that helps drip water back into your tank. You have a refractor meter. Salinity is important to this. You have the ammonia kit. My goodness, ammonia is so important to test every day, twice a day. We also have what you collect. We do collect our babies from the tank itself. I think it's more natural. We've tried it both ways, removing a tile and letting them hatch versus collecting them from the tank. We have a higher success rate collecting them naturally from the tank. I think the father is shimmying and keeping it going right up until they hatch. So I think it's healthier for them. And then you can see we've got some Amquell here too for the ammonia. And we have a bucket along with a little siphon. And then you have right here for straining the rotifers. All you have to do is go to the dollar store, get one of those plastic strainers and coffee filters, you're set. So it's not a lot of extra equipment, but this needs to be planned for in advance. And I'm sorry you really can't see these pictures. This is pretty cool. Now that we've planned for it, we've got our dedicated tank. We're waiting for batch 5 or 6, and we see the progression of the eggs. They start off bright pink, and they're going to go to a light brown, then almost black. By day 6 and 7, that's when you see their eyes shining through, and it's a silvery shimmer. They're not quite ready. Day 8, if you can look at the difference between day 7 and day 8, you're going to see that silver turns into a copper shimmer. When it turns into that copper shimmer and you've got them all coppery, that's the night. Usually it is night 8. We've been fortunate every single time for 4 years, it's 9-8. If the weather conditions are bad, if it's really cold out and the tank goes down by 2 or 3 degrees, it's day 9. But usually it's day 8, and it's when it's coppery is when they're going to hatch. Again, if you wait until batch 5 or 6, you're going to know the pattern of your fish. So, you're ready, it's night 8, and they're hatching, and you collect these babies. This is from our last hatch a few weeks ago. I brought this as a demonstration, because this was one of the hardest things for us to learn. This is what we use, a basic cup of white, and a $2 little LED light from any drugstore, $4. We put our cup in the tank, we turn the light on, and I have it dimmed even with a little paper towel. You put the light and shine it right back here and just lay that cup in there. Your larvae are going to swim right to it. They're attracted to the light. Now this is really, really cloudy again because of this. But this is a tank that shows all the teeny tiny little specks. It also shows how murky our tank is. And it's murky because it's filled with phytoplankton and it's loaded with rotifers. So when those babies are gently dumped into that larva tank, they're already starting life. Okay? Another thing about this that you can't see, again, is this. We did a no-no by filming this because we had to allow the light over top to shine directly on that larva. When I go over the lighting, you're going to see that's not really a good thing. But we wanted a great video, and you can see this video on Reef Geeks better to see everything. But the fish, if they have too much light, they're upside down. They're on a, they look like they're vertical. That's not good. Okay? So, I'm going to cover again. I actually, you might be able to see a little bit of them right now. Okay?